on the stage. Now let's all welcome Andy Smith.
Well, thank you, man. I'm gonna go without the mic.
All right, good.
Thank you. If you've studied world history, it's obvious there's only one country that's ever been a true superpower. That's the United States. Being a superpower requires three things: economic might, military might, and a system of laws and commerce that the rest of the world wants to emulate. The United States is the only country that has all three. And when it comes to the United States economy, make no mistake, it's America's entrepreneurs that make it all happen. They're the reason the rest of the world wants to be like us, and it explains our title, Entrepreneurs Make America Great. 30 years ago, only a handful of colleges taught even a single course on entrepreneurship. Entrepreneur Magazine wasn't started until 1977. Inc. Magazine didn't even exist. Today, there's almost 2,000 courses about entrepreneurship being taught at colleges and universities in the United States. I've been able to work with some amazing entrepreneurs over the past 25 years, and I've made a list of about 100 that I really got to know and understand well. In most cases, these are individuals who built businesses from scratch or took over a small business and built it into a very large and profitable one. I had many, many opportunities to work with them, and it's just been an awesome, awesome experience. When I talk about entrepreneurs today, I'm going to be generalizing about behavior characteristics of the very top 10% of all entrepreneurs I've worked with. I've had a front row seat. I've studied entrepreneurs like a scientist, and I'm going to share some of their success secrets with you. Now, if you've thought about being an entrepreneur at all, I've got some really good news. Entrepreneurs weren't born entrepreneurs. In every case, it's a result of thinking and behavior processes that they've learned or were taught. You don't need to be the class valedictorian, you don't need to start with a lot of money, and you certainly don't need an overly complex business plan. So, what is the number one key to entrepreneur success? It's entrepreneur thinking. Let me explain how entrepreneur thinking works. The entrepreneur has an idea and creates a vision for his or her business. And then to support the vision, the entrepreneur programs beliefs into their brain. And these beliefs are so strong and they're so powerful and so repetitive that they result in entrepreneur thinking that's just automatic behavior. And this thinking leads to habits, actions, and behaviors that lead to success and fulfillment, which leads to the ultimate prize of happiness. Now, I haven't met anyone who doesn't want to be happy. You want to be happy, I want to be happy. If you're an entrepreneur, to be happy requires that you achieve some level of success and fulfillment. And success and fulfillment is dependent on you having the right types of habits, actions, and behaviors. And it's our habits, actions, and behaviors that are a direct result of how we think. So it's how entrepreneurs think that is the real secret to their success. And you can learn to replicate their thinking and their success by simply adopting their habits, actions, and behaviors. And if you do so, you're going to dramatically shorten your own learning curve, and you'll avoid many of their mistakes. Now, this slide could be the all-time classic. It sounds simple, but it's not easy. I mean, really, if it were this simple, if I could create happiness and make everybody wealthy, I could change the world, right? And I personally struggle with this one. So let me share with you that, you know, in spite of the fact that I have spent years working with some of the most successful entrepreneurs, there are many times when I think like an absolute complete amateur. So my entrepreneur thinking is always just a work in progress at best. The good news about entrepreneur thinking is it's really nothing more than just a roadmap. And if you study it, you can learn it. And the more you learn, the bigger your dreams and vision will become, the more success and fun you'll have, and the more money you're gonna make. Entrepreneurs, they're optimists. They develop habits and attitudes that are optimistic. They're forward thinkers. They rarely complain. They tend to hang out with other people who are optimistic thinkers. Can a negative thinking person or a pessimist be a successful entrepreneur? I'm often asked that question. The answer is no. I've never met a successful entrepreneur that's a pessimist. So until I meet one, the answer is no. Entrepreneurs, they create empowering beliefs about themselves, about their vision, and about their business. And they do this way before they've even started the business, and certainly way before the business is anything close to being successful. These entrepreneurs, they've figured out how to reprogram all of the bad beliefs that most of us are raised with. Here's how the typical person, at least in the United States, is raised. Parents, teachers, coaches, ministers, relatives, friends, people of influence in a child's life, they say to the child, "This is fact." The child, it's just a child, they accept the perception of what is fact as if it's true, and even if it's totally false and wrong. They then ingrain these beliefs into their head and develop habits accordingly. The child grows into an adult, operating under dozens of faulty beliefs, and they do it at an unconscious level. Then the adult operates under limiting beliefs, and they begin to set boundaries for themselves. Again, they're completely and totally unaware of it. So just think of all of the beliefs that we've later learned weren't true at all. The world is flat. The earth revolves around the sun. Smoking expands your lung capacity. You know, certainly, this is a picture from the 1920s, Tour de France. I'm certain that these are two French guys passing a cigarette back and forth. I can only imagine their belief must have been that somehow smoking would enhance and improve their performance. I keep this picture in my home office. This is a baby circus elephant. When a circus elephant is a baby, they chain its foot to a stake. Little guy, he pulls on the stake, but he's not strong enough to pull the stake out of the ground. You know what happens when he becomes a big elephant? He doesn't even try. He's figured it out, his brain just doesn't register, so he doesn't even try to pull the stake out, and all he'd have to do is lift his head. And that probably, certainly that sounds crazy to all of us, but guys, adults do this all the time. We get some nut job belief into our head that we can't do something, and then we don't even attempt it. We don't even try. So this is exactly why young people with far less experience are so valuable to growing companies. They don't know what they don't know, and as a result, they're willing to try just about anything, and as a result, they can often accomplish just absolutely some extraordinary things. So be careful, don't be chained to your beliefs. There's also all sorts of false and crazy beliefs about being an entrepreneur that you'll hear. So you're gonna, as you go through your life and as you develop your skills and as you set your course and start thinking, there will come a time when you'll have some ideas and you'll bring them home to family, relatives, friends, and you'll say, "Hey, how about this entrepreneur thing?" And they're like, "Whoa, you know, this entrepreneur thing. Didn't you go to school to get an education so that you can just go get a job? That sounds risky." So the belief is that the entrepreneur, you're taking on some form of excessive risk. You know, that's a belief. Or if you're a significant other in a person's life who wants to do something entrepreneurial, they're thinking, "Wow, I heard that the last entrepreneur, he was an absolute workaholic. He ruined his family, ruined his marriages. His kids hated him. He grew up because all he did was work." So that's a belief. You know what? The entrepreneurs that I've worked with, that's not going to be true at all. So you're going to have dozens and dozens, and we can go on here, but there's going to be false beliefs about entrepreneurs. Sort them out. Don't believe it. I can tell you that I have seen many, many successful businesses that have been started as a direct result of the light bulb going on. They've asked the question, "Why do we always do it this way?" And the answer came back, "Well, that's pretty much the way we've always done it." And bingo, they've set course and started their own business. Entrepreneurs have a huge sense of urgency. To an entrepreneur, they are on a dream to fulfill their mission, and they know the clock is ticking. So they have a high sense of urgency. This is a gun to the head, get it done mentality. A sense of urgency, it's really all about defining what you want and then creating a plan and going after it and making sure that you get it. Let me ask you a question. What do you have a sense of urgency to do in your life? I won't make you answer that, but think about it. If you know, that's fantastic, because you can take some of the philosophies that we're talking about today and put them to use right now. If you don't know, make it your job to find out. I guarantee you when you do find that sense of urgency, it'll be, what do you love to do? What are you good at? What are you passionate about? It'll be a game changer for you. Entrepreneurs, they don't make excuses and they accept all the responsibility. When I go visit a business owner and visit their company and I get an opportunity to meet some of their employees and I hear them explain a challenging business situation and how they're going to deal with it. They've got plan A, plan B, plan C, and I'm probably not going to hear an excuse. I know that's a great company. I know that when I see the financial statements, I'm probably going to be seeing good things. The reverse of that is true. When you go into a company and all you hear is, hey, it's somebody else's fault, and they're pointing every which way and they refuse to accept the responsibility, that's the sign of a bad company. We're going to talk more about this towards the end, but this whole concept of lifelong learning and being able to copy the success of others, entrepreneurs shamelessly copy the success of others. If they see a good idea, the entrepreneur is out there, they're going to copy it. They're going to refabricate that good idea, and they're going to make sure that they can repackage it and put it into a different format. So school's never out. Learning never ends. I heard that said. I put on my sheet what I think is a true treasure map of resources that are available. This is what I selected from probably a couple hundred books that I studied about entrepreneur success. And if you take those and read some of them, it's going to lead you to what your interests are, and I think it will, again, shorten your learning curve. That's what this is all about. That's what education does, and that's what we're doing. Entrepreneurs, they see the world differently. They develop a different perspective. In the early 1990s, there was a little thing called the internet. It was just getting going. And there weren't many commercial applications. There was a guy named Jeff Bezos. He was working on Wall Street for a little company, and he saw that the internet was growing at an annual rate of about 2,300% a year, but we really didn't have any commercial applications. This was, scientists and NASA astronauts and people using it for different things. And so he researched it, and he figured out that a great use of the internet would be its large ability to host a lot of electronic information that was sorted. In the early 90s, there were many successful mail order catalog companies. Everyone can remember the day where you'd call up on the phone, you'd give the people the credit card, and it would show up in your mailbox, and there was no real application for the internet. So he found that books would be just an ideal thing to put on the internet. So this was obviously the founding of Amazon.com. Amazon.com is a great entrepreneur story. They lost money for a long, long time, up until like 2002. Everybody kind of laughed, but the point is that Jeff Bezos, he's kept his eye on the ball, he kept going, kept raising money, got over all of the obstacles because he saw the world a little bit differently. I want you to look at this next slide very closely. You've seen the logo probably thousands of times. I want you to study it closely. Look at the letters, look at the colors, the outlines, the shape. If you can see the little R in the lower right-hand corner, raise your hand if you see an arrow. Okay, so a lot of people don't see the arrow when I've looked at it before. Now look between the E and the X. Raise your hand. You see the arrow? I'm going to point to it over here on the left. When you see that FedEx arrow now, when you see the truck, you're always going to see the arrow. So it's just a function of perspective. So many of these entrepreneurs, they've seen something, they've had a vision that other people didn't see, and they've been able to take action because they're prepared for it and then be able to jump on the opportunity. So perspective is a very interesting thing to be able to start businesses with. Now this next slide, if you would look at it, if you can understand the perspective, I would like to talk to you about a job in New York City, as an investment banker, because the perspective that we're always very challenged with is the buyer's perspective, which is that little bag of money, and the seller's perspective. So You know, earlier in my career, I'm generally representing sellers of businesses and sellers of security positions. And I would become very frustrated by buyers who would want to show up with the little bags of money. You know, and then I realized that that's just what buyers do. They want to, you know, be cheap and, you know, pay it. And what I learned is that I had to do a better job as a salesperson to educate that buyer on what the future opportunity was. And when we do that, we get a lot closer and we're able to get deals done. You know, entrepreneurs are able to manage risk and criticism. To most people, to the average person, just having a roof over their head, having a meals to eat, and just kind of coasting through to a good retirement where maybe you can collect some Social Security, that's the average person. To an entrepreneur, I'm absolutely convinced that they don't even see risk. Risk doesn't even process in their brain. And it's not because the entrepreneurs are more courageous than the average person. It's really because the entrepreneur believes, again, we get back to beliefs, the entrepreneur believes that whatever they might lose, they'll be able to win back. So to them, it's not risk at all. It's just the way they're managed and the way they operate. And then they simply ignore the critics. When you're successful, when you're doing things, people will criticize you. To the entrepreneur, they're so busy and so focused on what they do that they'll never even let that impact their thinking. Anytime you look at a successful business, think of Southwest Airlines, think of FedEx, you know, think of Amazon.com. I guarantee you it is a story of that company and the entrepreneur who founded it being able to overcome multiple setbacks and even failures. So the course of the entrepreneur, you know, it's certainly not a linear straight line up. They're able to go around, they're able to identify what those factors are. They just don't stop. They come up with plan A, plan B. There are no failures if you're an entrepreneur. There's just short-term setbacks. So when you look at it that way, and that becomes your perspective of looking at the world, guys, where's the risk? You know, I don't think the entrepreneurs really get there. This is a great one. It's just about entrepreneurs have fun. They have genuine fun running their business. So if you never want to work another day in your life, you're cut out to be an entrepreneur, because entrepreneurs don't view real work as work and running their business. To them, that's just what they do. It becomes part of who they are. Now, you know, this whole have fun thing, this is where the best entrepreneurs have really learned to strike a life balance. So it's a false belief, I think, that entrepreneurs are total workaholics. No, entrepreneurs have learned that rest and recovery are an absolutely essential part of being at the top of your game. It's not to say that there aren't many periods, long periods of time, when you're starting a business and growing a business, that you're working 18-hour days for multiple straight days and weeks at a time. That comes with the territory. But they have learned to be able to balance out the life. That includes your family, includes your community, it includes your personal health and fitness, it includes your relationships. And the best entrepreneurs, they keep that balance, and it makes the wheel turn, and it does so, and that's how they work, that's how they run their life. Then entrepreneurs, you know, they are very notable for this. The top entrepreneurs, and even the ones who are still going, they're very thankful for what they've had. They're thankful for their roots and their beginnings, and they tell you about it. And they give back. And they don't wait until they're multimillionaires to give back. They're giving back. They're giving back to their communities. They're giving back to their families. They're giving back to the employees. And by having the business, they know that they're a good corporate citizen. And I can tell you from, you know, personal knowledge and experience, there's part of what the give back is that's actually public, and then for everything that you see, it's like a big iceberg. There's a lot more that you'll never see and never know, because they tend to be private about their giving. But just a tremendous part that speaks a lot to the character, you know, of entrepreneurs. All right, let's cut to the good stuff here. Let's development of skill sets. So by the time you're in third grade, you are developing different skill sets. Every job that you've ever had, you're developing skill sets. Every course that you've ever attended, you're developing skill sets. In fact, your job before you become an entrepreneur is to get as good as you possibly can at it, and you know what? Get paid to do it. So I want everyone who's interested to take away the big takeaway is that you can get paid to develop your skill sets. It's called a job, and it's not a bad thing. And so get paid to learn while you're along the way. I was on a flight from New York to Chicago a couple months ago, and a very impressive woman who was probably close to 60 years old sat next to me, and I started to ask her what she does for business, and she had started her own consultancy business as a development fundraiser for religious high schools and grade schools and churches. And I said, well, how did you get into that? You know, just kind of an opening line, and I was just absolutely fascinated. She had gone through a series of bank jobs, three banks. She was laid off at all of them through, you know, the economy and the mergers and acquisitions and, you know, all the good stuff that's a reality of the business. Went through a long period of just flat out unemployment. She says, I'm done with the banking world. I'm going to change my career into development. And she, very accomplished woman, went for 13 interviews. 13 interviews, didn't get a job. And they always said, hey, you know what, you don't have any experience. We like you, you're banking, we just don't see the crossover, we can't hire you, we can't take the risk because you don't have any experience. You know what she did? She went and she volunteered at her church for a capital campaign. She lived out in California, and she was part of a $6 million capital campaign, part of which she was responsible for, but you know, 99% of the success was, you know, other people. She was learning on the job. So guess what? She polished up her resume, and then she's almost in business. She got a job, and in 6 months, she realized that everything that she really knew, she could do on her own. Her little business in a year and a half has 8 employees, and I was just absolutely blown away. So get paid to learn. Top skill set is probably being able to manage money and then being able to sell. If you're an entrepreneur, you have to learn how to sell yourself, your business, your product, your service, you know, whatever that is. Negotiating, communication skills. I've had one of the area entrepreneurs, Bob Shafio, very, very successful guy on the people skills side. He says, Andy, if you're an entrepreneur, you're both a coach and a salesman. You know, and I think that's probably some of the best advice, you know, I've ever gotten. Next thing is to develop habits. Most people think of habits as something to break. I want to stop smoking. I want to quit overeating. I want to stop being a lazy couch potato. To an entrepreneur, habits is the other thing. They have worked very, very hard to develop automatic entrepreneur habits that are positive habits. And so the positive habits, you know, they start with being polite and courteous. These entrepreneurs, they are disarmingly polite and courteous. I mean, so much that you really tend to like them. So that when you're on the other side, or if you're a service provider, God, I like this person. I want to do business with them. Guess what? If you're a service provider, you're probably getting your best deal. You're in your best service to those types of people. So that's a good one. The habit of punctuality, the habit of doing more than you say you're going to do, the habit of doing more than you're paid to do. On and on and on, all of those things, don't wait, start developing skill sets. If you have some bad habits that you need to correct, and we all do, don't try to change everything overnight. Start with one thing, and then the following week, do two things, and then the next, and it becomes a cumulative thing. And when you go through life and most of what you're doing is good positive habits, there's a huge momentum factor that just takes over. So getting started in your business, when you have a business idea, it starts with the idea. You got to figure out, can I fill a need? Is there a need for my idea? If there's not a need for an idea, you probably don't have a business. But it is the American way, where we have an idea and we see a need. In America, it's called entrepreneurs, and we go out and we start businesses, and that's what gives us the competitive edge as a country. So most of your businesses, it's some combination of either a product, you know, or a service. So you got to figure out, be crystal clear, do you have a product or do you have a service, and know the difference. And then the number one thing that you've got to be able to do? Can you get paid for it? Because if you can't get paid for it, you don't have a business. What you have is a part-time job, or part-time income and a full-time job at that point. And it's absolutely essential. It's your responsibility as an entrepreneur to find a way to create something that's going to make the business money, make you money, and protect the business. That's why they call it. So never apologize for being in business to make money, because that's what entrepreneurs do. Usually there's better, faster, cheaper. There's three reasons to be in business. So we've heard of the three rules of real estate: location, location, location. Although, you know, I've seen a lot of great locations that are completely underwater these days. Better, faster, cheaper, or some combination is usually a great way. We've had a client, our firm Houlihan Capital, we represented some business owners who started a business. They were both manufacturers reps. And they didn't start their business until they were in their mid-50s. And the line of products that they were representing as manufacturers reps was declining pretty hard. And they realized that, hey, we're either going to be unemployed and retired early, or we've got to do something, take action, put it into our own hands. So they came up with this idea of decorative flags, unbranded decorative flags. So if you could picture, you know, a birthday cake, a Mother's Day flag, a graduation flag, an Easter flag, a Halloween flag, a flag for every occasion was what their motto was. And they told me something, and this was a business, guys, that was making tens of millions of dollars every year, you know, in net cash flow income. So this was no, you know, back of the store business. And these two guys said, what we did is we figured out, and this was no scientific study, but they figured out that an average housewife would be willing to pay somewhere between $7 and $9 for one of these fancy decorative flags. And then they work backwards to figure out, how do I design, manufacture, and get flags shipped to us that we could ship to our customers in a supply chain, you know, and really make money. And when they did that, they were able to get these flags manufactured. You know, I think their lowest price was somewhere between 76 cents and $1.03. So they really had a lot of high margin in that, and that wasn't done in the United States. They went offshore to get that done. But, you know, two great guys, they built a wonderful company. And because of better, faster, and cheaper, they knew where they fit there. When it comes time to put together a business plan, we like simple, we like concise, and we like to see a lot of action, you know, immediate action. So I judge a business plan by, is there a focus on revenues? So if I'm, you know, reading about everything else, I want to see a real focus on who's your customer, what's the size of your market, what's the opportunity, and when are we going to see some revenues, you know, coming in there. If you make it too complex, if you don't keep it simple, I guarantee you you're going to get sucked into this endless quagmire of overanalysis, indecision, second guessing, and just paralysis that you're not going to be able to move and take action and get out and sell. So be very careful. Avoid the temptation to make your business plans overly, you know, complex. Have a bias towards action, you know, in them. It's time for an entrepreneur quiz for everybody. It's an entrepreneur quiz. So we're going to take a show of hands. There's six frogs sitting on a lily pad. One of the frogs decides to jump off. How many are left? I'll say it again. There's six frogs sitting on a lily pad. One of the frogs decides to jump off. How many are left? So how many people say five? Let me see a show of hands. Show of hands for five. Who's buried in Grant's tomb? It's a logical answer. How many say zero? Okay. One of the frogs jumped off, knocked all the other frogs into the water. How many say six? Very good. The six frogs making a decision is not taking action. So entrepreneurs have to take action. We develop our skill sets so that we can become prepared so that when there's an opportunity, we're able to take action. If you look on the map at the intersection of preparation and opportunity, it's action that's going to ignite it. So action is the spark that's going to ignite entrepreneur opportunities. And always have a bias towards actions. Revenues and expenses. So everyone should know this, but we'll get basic. Revenues is cash that comes in the door from our sales. Expenses is cash that goes out the door, you know, from disbursements. When you're an entrepreneur, and particularly when you're in the early stages of the business, you're in a very, very fragile startup mode. So it's absolutely critical that you understand what your revenues are going to be, because that's the cash that you're going to have, and what your expenses are going to be. So you need to be crystal clear on that. There are two four-letter words that are the friend of the entrepreneur when you're in startup mode. The first one is cash. So we rank our actions by their nearness to cash. Any of the accounting students in here, it's just like a balance sheet. You know, cash, accounts receivable, inventory. Rank your actions by their nearness to cash. The other four-letter word is the word free, because the word free is going to allow you to reduce your expenses so that there's more cash left over, you know, for you and the business at the end of the day. So when you say free, think in terms of, it's a very, you know, empowering word, right? I just love saying, I think it's one of the most powerful words in the whole English language, the word free. I think of a free utility, you know, a free application, free advice. So the word free, and there's many opportunities and free resources when you're an entrepreneur, particularly startup entrepreneurs, that if you're resourceful, you can leverage your ideas and leverage your everything that you have and be able to get more. When we say margins and profits, your margin is really just the percentage of your total revenue that's going to remain as profit after your expenses are gone. Again, that's a number that you got to know. You just don't kind of know it. That's a number that you as an entrepreneur absolutely have to know and understand. So spend a little less time on the business plan and spend a lot more time focusing on revenues, expenses, you know, margins and profits, and it's usually a good thing. The elevator pitch. You'd be amazed at how many smart business owners, how many great businesses, they've really got a lousy description of their business. You ask them, what is it that the business does? And they go on and on and on, and they've got some convoluted explanation for what their business is, and I don't even understand it after listening to it for 5 minutes. And so that's not who you want to be. You want to be the guy who can deliver the absolute perfect elevator pitch that describes your business. An elevator pitch, you know, describes the opportunity, it describes the size of the market, who's your customer, what are the barriers to entry, what are your competitive advantages vis-a-vis your competition, what are your margins and revenues going to be, and what are your key demand drivers for your product, you know, or service. So that's an elevator pitch. Get yours crystal clear. Think about it. There's a little company called Google who I think has got a wonderful elevator pitch that kind of serves as a mission statement. It's 12 words, guys, to organize the world's information and make it universally accessible and useful. Nobody's confused by what Google does. What they do in the future, I think, and pretty much, that's an ingenious, you know, kind of elevator pitch and description. People have asked me, what's Houlihan Capital's elevator pitch? We do multiple lines of business, but when we're representing a business owner in the sale of their business, so something that they have worked a lifetime to achieve, what I use as my elevator pitch is that I'll help you explain the past, sell the future, and get you the highest price and best terms. I know that business owner wants the big bag of money, you know, not the small one. So that's my elevator pitch, and we're very often successful with it. Back to managing money. If you're going to be an entrepreneur, before you can be an entrepreneur, you've got to figure out how to be able to manage some of your own money first. So yes, this means that you actually have to earn and save your own money. And by doing this, you have to learn how to manage it. And so let's say you haven't had the benefit of being a bank teller, or you haven't had the benefit of working at multiple jobs in fast food restaurants where you get to get paid to learn the skill of money management because you're reconciling a cash register. Let's learn some of the basic software that's out there. Most businesses, small businesses, QuickBooks will be your financial and accounting system. And you can save thousands of dollars and run your businesses. Entrepreneurs who can't tell me what their numbers are when I ask them, I really have a hard time with. As a small business owner, you've got to be managing your own money. You've got to be on top of your cash. You've got to know all of the numbers. So get familiar with those those three. If you do open a bank account, find a free online checking, and even if there's no activity, on a daily basis, you should be balancing every cash account that you have, you know, in your company. That's how fragile and that's how important, you know, cash is. So if you look at this picture, George Washington is holding his head, not because the federal government almost shut down last week, but because George knows that entrepreneurs, and it's one of our beliefs, this is one of those belief things that we're all raised with, you shouldn't be talking about money. You know what, if you're an entrepreneur, you have got to learn to be comfortable talking about money. So, in fact, to be an entrepreneur, you've got to be talking about money to your customers, to your clients, to your vendors, to your service providers. It's okay to let the employees know that you're in business to make money. They become part of that process. And the more comfortable you become talking about money, the faster you're going to be able to develop your business and grow. You've got to learn how to manage employees. Every business owner, we all have our strengths and our limitations and things that we're just not good at. You know, in my case, I would find people who would do things that I was horrible at, and they would love to do them, and I would learn to step aside and just let them run with it. And when I did it, it allowed me to do some of the things that I did better, which is usually go out and sell, and the business would come in. So you have to learn how to find out where's your strength so that you can play to your strength. If you have weaknesses, find other people, other resources to be able to do that. There's no one place that you go to. There's no one book that you have. You guys have just got to figure it out, and that's part of the, it's going to be part of the job. It's part of the kind of the growth and frustration of running a business, and I think entrepreneurs who have done it can talk to you about it. Ready, fire, aim. Now, I get criticized for this sometimes because it kind of sounds reckless, doesn't it? Kind of sounds Dick Cheney-like. You know, ready, fire, aim. So it's sloppy, like we haven't planned, and that's not the case at all. Ready, fire, aim, it's all about taking action as an entrepreneur and being able to take action quickly, not being paralyzed and, you know, no more over-analysis. We look at the information and we study it hard. We develop plan A, plan B, plan C. We make a decision, we take action, and then an entrepreneur, you go for it. It's ready, fire, aim, it's a fundamental. We use it in our business all the time, and I suggest that you would be well served to use it in yours as well. Fake it until you make it. So let me make a news announcement to all aspiring entrepreneurs that clients and customers aren't real keen about working with just startup businesses that look kind of like maybe they won't be around. So you as an entrepreneur, to be successful, you have to begin thinking successfully, and you have to project to the image to the public and to your customers that confidence, that you understand your business, that you're, if you're providing a service, that you're going to be there forever to do it, that you're growing your company larger, and that gets communicated to your customers, and as a result, you can sell it. It's a tough thing to do. You have to fake it till you make it. In my own business, I started our investment banking firm, original one, in 1996. I did it from the basement of our house. And I had a service, you know, with a fancy address, and all of the phone calls were answered by an operator, and they would simply transfer them to me in my basement, and I was usually, you know, sometimes I'd be in my pajamas. My clients didn't know. They didn't need to know that I was a one-man band, and I did that for 3 years, had two employees, and I was working out of my basement. We were doing a couple million in sales. So fake it till you make it. It's a good technique for entrepreneurs, particularly for home-based service businesses to get started. The golden rules, and you're going to realize that this is a plural. So the first rule that you never break is you treat people with respect and you treat people the way that you want to be treated. And the top entrepreneurs, this is a rule that they never break. I'm just amazed at how polite and courteous they are, and with what great respect they treat their employees, their customers, their service providers. The second gold rule is that the guys with the gold and the guys with the money are going to make the rules. So if you're an entrepreneur and you're getting money into your company, either in the form of debt, equity, or some combination of debt and equity, be very careful, because the guys with the money tend to make the rules. So you need to understand it, That's when you need to talk to other business owners and other entrepreneurs. Sometimes, and there are the right times to raise money, but there's the wrong times to raise money as well. So that is a really tough one. There's four key fundamentals that I have come up with that I believe every entrepreneur needs to be successful in business. You need to first learn to handle frustration. So if you're going to start a successful business, I guarantee you will have frustration. So things will not go according to your business plan. If you use Ready, Fire, Aim, it's going to go differently than what you had planned. And there's just simply a lot of frustration trying to get up and running, do all the things that you have to do as a business owner when the business, particularly in the startup days, where the business isn't big enough and or profitable enough to afford all the different services that big companies simply outsource, you know, and pay for. A lot of that has to be done by you. So there's huge, huge amounts of frustration. If you want to make massive amounts of money, though, get used to dealing with massive amounts of frustration. It comes with the, you know, it comes with the territory. The next thing you've got to be comfortable with is rejection. So remember we talked about selling? So nobody teaches you how to sell. Unfortunately, that's not part of the curriculum. I think it should be. And there are a lot of very, very good resources on how to sell. If you look at my little resource sheet that I sent out, there was some suggested readings. Those will lead you to some courses and some real shortcut selling techniques that if you've been in sales, if you study those, it'll just shorten, you'll get up to speed a lot faster than trying to learn it through trial and error. So nobody likes rejection. I don't like rejection, and but our company, and we've figured out a way to do it. A lot of companies have figured out a way to do it. If you think about an insurance company, large insurance companies, they're able to predict with high precision how many people are going to die by region of the country, by age, by gender. What they can't tell you is who is going to die, can they? And so they're able to do this using the law of large numbers. So when you're in a sales mode, consider using the law of large numbers. Let me explain a way our company did this. Three or four years ago, we got a call from a large public company. We provide valuation services on illiquid securities. And they owned some auction rate securities, $400 million of them. And they asked the question, could we value these auction rate securities? And though we've never valued them, I knew the right answer to that question. The answer was yes. We completed the valuation. Our analysts built a beautiful model. The auditors loved it. The company loved it. We delivered it. We got paid. Everybody's happy. We then looked and we said, geez, wouldn't it be nice if we could sell a lot more of these things? But who else owns auction rate securities, you know, at those types of levels? And we thought, well, other big public companies that have a lot of cash probably own auction rate securities, but how would we find out? How would we get to them? So what we did is we ran a screen of all public companies, and there's, you know, several thousands of public companies, and we came up with about 900 public companies that we thought had a lot of cash, or we saw that they had a lot of interest income, you know, on their financial statements through their income statement. Interest income meant that they probably had big cash balances, so they must have been getting that interest income from somewhere. And so we do the math with me. There's 900 big companies, so some of the biggest companies in the United States. And so each of these companies probably had, on average, 9 or 10 people in their accounting and treasury group. So who would you even call, you know, at one of these big companies to find out, can we sell you a valuation for auction rate securities? So what we did is we used the law of large numbers. We put it into a database. We split up the list amongst about 8 people. And we absolutely carpet bombed them with phone calls, emails, faxes. And when we called, we just didn't say, hey, yeah, this is us, and try to leave a message in the voicemail and hope that we get a call back. We would hit zero, and we would say, I'm trying to reach Mr. Lemerand. I have something very important to share with him regarding auction rate securities. Please have him call me. And so we signed up in a 90-day period 150 new public company clients, not because we were great salespeople, but simply because we used the law of large numbers. Now, we were rejected. Our rejection rate, you know, would make our batting average was bad, you know, but we signed up 150 new clients. Now, The worst thing that happened from that experience was that one of the treasurers of the company called me up and he said, you know what, I have 11 people in my department and all of them report to me. And best I can tell, your company has called us 33 times and I find it to be very obnoxious. And you know what, he became our client too, so he got over it. So put the law of large numbers to you to work and you're never gonna feel the bad part of the rejection. You've got to be able to handle, as a business owner, financial pressure. So when you're starting a business, there's financial pressure. You just made a sale, but you haven't been paid. It's financial pressure. You have a payroll to meet. That's financial pressure. You're growing the business, or you're making an acquisition, or you're expanding, you know, into a new line. That takes cash. That's financial pressure. What you have to be able to do is you have to be able to operate that business with financial pressure and not let it impact who you are, how you talk with your customers, how you talk with the vendors. If you walk in and you know all the employees say, oh, hey, you let them know that you're feeling all of these financial pressures, that's just not a good thing. And then the final thing that you need to be able to deal with as a business owner and get past is complacency. So complacency, as you probably know, is when you stop, you're gonna go down. So when you stop taking risks, when you stop setting goals, when you stop doing new things, when you stop selling, when you stop following the golden rules, when you let your good habits become sloppy habits, your business is gonna become complacent and you're going to begin to set yourself up for failure. So the good businesses are constantly figuring out how to reinvent themselves. The greatest entrepreneurs are constantly, every few years, able to reinvent themselves. You know, look at the Steve Jobs, the Michael Dells. It's constant public pressure, but they've been able to just do extraordinary, you know, work, and they started it from a very, very small place. We're back to a point that we made earlier, that learning never ends, and you know, being an entrepreneur and using education as really the basic training to get started. But you are sucking up everything that you can like a sponge. Every piece of information, every person that you meet, you can shorten your path. Sam Walton did this when he started Walmart. You know, it's often said that Sam, you know, people would come in and he would just absolutely, he would know everything about them, everything about their business, and he would just take in all that information. So entrepreneurs, you do the same. Again, look at that reading list that I've given you. If you want a shortcut, you can exclude a lot of things. Just follow. Read the top 10 books on that list. Read Gil Lemerand's book and Bernie Simpkin's book, because it will shorten your path to success as an entrepreneur. I see some tremendous growth areas for entrepreneurs and entrepreneurial opportunities over the next 10 to 20 years. So this is exciting. So remember perspective. So one of the perspectives that we have in today's economy is that this economy is a really tough economy, right? Everybody thinks it's a tough economy. You know, it's compared to what? You know, compared to 1929 when we had the Great Depression. You know, compared to after World War II. You know, if you're in Japan. So sometimes it's economies like this where some of the greatest opportunities, you know, exist. Interest rates, gosh, they're close to zero. That is a fabulous thing. Inflation is close to zero. You know, I graduated from college in 1982. The prime rate in this country was 21%, 6 months before I graduated. I'm glad I was young and dumb and I didn't understand what that meant. But this economy, I think it's a great economy to begin planting the seeds of entrepreneurship, and I see growth areas, you know, in industries where we have issues. The computer capability and mapping capability that we now have for the brain, 30 years ago, you didn't see a chains of health clubs, you know, all along the United States. I think that you're gonna see recreational and commercial uses spring up for brain centers and different brain therapeutic, recreational. People will go on vacation, you know, just to be like the movie Total Recall. Be pretty cool. I keep another picture in my home office. This is you see a black and white, but this is a guy named Roger Bannister. Up until 1954, the belief in the world was that nobody could run a mile in less than 4 minutes. They had tried and tried. They'd gotten really close. And, you know, they can get it down to like 401, 402. But it really became a long time psychological barrier to be able to break that 4 minute mile. Within, he finally did it. He was a busy med student studying in Oxford, England. And he finally did it. It was 359.4. And when he did it, within 3 years, 16 other people ran that fast or faster. So let me ask you the question. Was that a real limiting factor, or was that a psychological factor? So everybody, me, you, everyone has got their own limiting factors about what we're going to do in our life, what resources we have available, what we can do and what we can't do. And you have to make a determination. Is that belief real? Is your limiting factor real? Or is it just a temporary limiting factor because you can make a change to steer around it? And that's really what I think this is all about here. We're trying to get you to use the resources that are available to you. And guess what? Many of these resources are that four-letter word, free. And it's up to you to be able to put them to use. And when you do, there's tremendous opportunities that are available. The United States is the greatest country in the history of the world. I think we're the greatest country because we have such strong entrepreneurs. So I'm going to, close it simply by saying that entrepreneurs take ideas and they leverage them and they provide solutions that solve problems. And certainly the United States and the world, we've got a lot of problems. And it's my hope that some of the next generation of America's entrepreneurs, are in this room tonight. Remember, it starts with thinking. Challenge your beliefs. Develop skill sets, create great habits, have fun, remember to give back, have a sense of urgency, be a lifetime learner, copy the success of others, and don't quit. And one more very, very important thing. When you've built a multi-million dollar profitable business, and it comes time to sell or raise money for that company, call me, because I'm going to get you the big bag of money. Thank you.